Welcome back to Bros in a Landfill, where the B stands for bullshit and the V stands for
Brains.
videos that are better than Yu-Gi-Oh! Brains.
Yikes!
Hey. Welcome back to the Brain Shitcast. Your host for this week are me.
Welcome back to Bros in a Landfill. Your hosts for today are talking right now, and if you can't figure out who we are, then you're watching the wrong show, motherfucker.
Welcome back to Bros in a Landfill, the only show with the hearts of in our cards of Your hosts for the week are Tar the Sky Dragon,
Roar.
Dizzy the Tormentor,
Why aren't I the trap card?
and me, Try. Whatever that third one, chicken, gold, whatever is.
No, you're just yellow Ojama.
I'm yellow.
Yeah, there's so
Can't that be
many.
Ojama King? Why didn't I use the Ojamas? Because the three of us clearly make the Ojama King, which is lunch.
Which is, we make lunch, we do the fusion ha three-way and become a just lunch.
I'm glad I didn't
Yes.
do the opening quip this week because I'm running out.
That's cool. Yeah, you gotta work
Don't
on them. Anyways.
shut up. All of you,
So
shut
in
up.
the
I'm
no.
taking my
What do you want,
turn.
Dizzy?
I'm taking my
Okay.
turn.
So take your turn already, asshole. Play your
Make sure
cards.
you make sure to draw first.
Yeah, you do that. That's important.
No, because you don't draw first if you go first anymore.
Oh.
Oh yeah.
I don't
Well, I
think
thought I
it's.
went first.
Wait. What?
Yeah,
I'm
that's a new
very
rule.
confused. We're talking about Yu-Gi-Oh today because we haven't
Yeah.
bitched about that enough.
Especially because I was bitching in the Discord about Yu-Gi-Oh! Brains. So, yeah. Like every week, I do.
Apparently, it's a new official rule that the first person to start the duel does not draw.
Been
So
like that
you start
since
with.
series
Ever.
one. Yeah.
No, that was. You drew at the start of your turn, no matter what, up until, like, I think a year ago.
No, it was way before a year ago.
Really?
Yeah, no, okay.
You start a
In
duel, you
Yu-Gi-Oh!
draw a
Okay.
card, but
Okay,
now it's you
this
start a
was
duel, and then after you end your turn, then you start drawing cards at the start of your turn.
like before the GX era when they started doing the you only draw on the second turn because it was kind of too OP drawing on the
Really?
first turn. Yeah.
Man, I only got my knowledge from the anime, so I guess they're a bunch of hack
Well,
frauds.
the anime breaks all the rules, which is actually kind of funny because Vrains is a bit more faithful to the actual card like rules of the card game, a bit more faithful, but
Is that
to
what
some
makes it
degree.
boring? I've never seen Brains.
Okay, so
I
Vrains
saw
is
one
boring.
duel, and it was really boring.
Okay, so Vrains is the way it handles its duel, which is it's actually kind of funny because before this was Arc V, which was like its own sort of like not giving any fuck about the actual what makes Yu-Gi-Oh work. It was just a bunch of entertainment fun of Yu-Gi-Oh. Where Vrains is kind of like the exact opposite, where it kind of takes the game card game so seriously that it kind of misses the entertainment value within said card game.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I haven't seen a whole lot of Vrains duels, but it's like a lot of people joke about how in Yu-Gi-Oh, like, they say, I'm gonna activate this card and then explain what it does. But a lot of the time in Yu-Gi-Oh, it's like most of the conversation is just people yelling at each other, and occasionally a card game happens. What I've seen of Vrains is literally just this card does this, and now I do this. And I'm like, thanks for the check sheet, buddy. You don't even have to talk at this point.
Yeah. Like,
Okay,
then I'll
but
tribute my
guys,
three
well,
monsters so I can
okay.
summon Gaia the Fierce Knight and attack you directly. And it's like, yeah, okay, Yugi also said that he tributes his monsters to summon Gaia, but he
But
also had three
Yugi's got crazy hair and a big personality, so it's fun to watch when he explains his cards.
Yugi also had three episodes of banter when he was going back and forth with a person who was trying to kill him with a children's card game.
Well, with the original Yu-Gi-Oh, the stakes were so ridiculously high all the time that it was inherently engaging, where the stakes never really exist in Vrains, outside of like one like mini arc within the first arc.
Damn it, you guys, you were supposed to let me talk so I could make my joke about how Pot of Greed lets you draw two cards.
Okay, make the joke about how Pot of Greed lets you draw two cards.
Yes, Tar, please tell us about how Pot of Greed lets you draw two cards.
I play Pot of Greed and it lets me draw two cards.
I'm glad to know that Pot of Greed lets you draw two cards.
Oh boy, man, Pot of Greed lets you draw two cards. This episode sucks. I'm leaving.
So
bye.
Before we get too much more into Vrains, because Dizzy and I were starting to go on a little bit of a tangent, I think it's important for us to explain to the audience and to Tar what exactly makes Vrains Vrains as opposed to any other Yu-Gi-Oh! Series.
Stages. So, I haven't watched the show.
I love how this is for the audience and also for me.
Yes. Well, I guess also for Dizzy, because Dizzy's only seen clips on YouTube. He has, like, have you watched any full episode of Vrains?
I've only watched one duel, and that was all I needed to see to think, yeah, I don't want to watch
That was all you needed to see before you went, yikes,
Yu-Gi-Oh! Vrains copyright claimed one of my streams.
What?
Fuck them. Yeah, I stream on YouTube, by the way. Go check me out. Link's not below. But yeah, one of my streams got copyright claimed because it had some music in it. I got copyrighted by Konami.
It was such a good stream, too.
I don't follow streams.
Anyways.
Tar doesn't watch.
So, if you didn't know about anything about Yu-Gi-Oh! Vrains, all I need to tell you is that it's what would happen if Yu-Gi-Oh! Took place in a VR MMO.
Okay, and back the fuck up. What?
It would happen if Yu-Gi-Oh! Took place in a VR MMO.
That's Sword Art on Yu-Gi-Oh!
Excuse me, that is offensive to Sword Art Online because Sword Art Online has at least pretty colors.
If you die in the duel, die in real life.
Sword Art Online at least has moments where it's a little bit entertaining to watch, and it's got some like big, fun, stupid scenes, or like amazing action scenes, or amazing music. There is nothing inherently engaging about Vrains. There is no reason to watch it, and I know what you're gonna say, but
no, you don't. Yeah. Let me ask you a question: is at any point in Yu-Gi-Oh! Vrains, is there a part where the main character or somebody's arms just start flailing around because the motion controls are garbage?
I wish. That would actually make that actually be something to like laugh about.
It's my turn. Once my hand gets to my deck. Oh god. Maybe if I use both arms. Well, oh god. Oh.
What is this? Inverted controls?
Well, Vrains works under the same like VR logic that Sword Art Online does, where you're kind of just uploading your brain into the server, that your body's essentially in a coma while you're playing the game.
I would love it so much if there was a scene where like they're in some big evil fortress and it's being blown up because they beat the boss, and they're like rushing to open the doors, and they're like, "Open the doors, hurry!" And it's like, "Put your hand over the door for 3 seconds, and it will open." And it's like, "My hand keeps slipping. These motion controls are terrible."
Come on, Dizzy, stop making a better show than Vrains.
No.
Oh!
The place is, like, blowing up around them, and they're like, "Here, I'll do it!" And it's like, whoop, and it's like, "How did you get the motion controls to work so well?" Like, simple. I just stuck them in my mouth. They just all look at the main character like he's crazy and goes, "What?" Just nothing. Thanks for saving us, man. Like, yeah. Like, giving him weird looks like, "Yeah, buddy. You're the man." He's like, "What?"
I know nothing about VR, so I'm just along for this ride.
I know there was like a Yu-Gi-Oh! VR game that came out that apparently wasn't very good.
Yikes.
That's most Yu-Gi-Oh! Games that aren't just playing the card game.
What about the Yu-Gi-Oh! Dating game?
There was a Yu-Gi-Oh! Dating game?
There was a Yu-Gi-Oh! Dating game?
Yeah, it's called Yu-Gi-Oh! Tag Force. I'm not even kidding. Characters like legit fall in love with you.
You know what? I'm okay with that. I'm absolutely okay with that.
I'd court Taya Gardner.
No, that's only GX and 5Ds.
I'd court Alexis.
I was about to say that.
You could, I guess. But she's really boring.
But she's hot, though.
You have a girlfriend and you're married. Try.
You sickos.
How dare you?
Sacrilege. But Alexis is also hot.
I'm sure Dizzy would Cord Chumley.
I don't know what I should say there, because in GX, Chumley was not a dateable character in the Tag Force 1, so like, I don't know if I should go with I would if he was playable, or if I would go with, nah, I'd date, and then, like, insert lamer character or something. Nah, I'd date Crowler or something.
Yikes!
Dizzy exposed much.
Isn't Crowler, like, a legit incel?
He's also not dateable, so it doesn't matter. You can only date the main characters, who are also teenagers.
So, back on to Vrains. So, when you think of Yu-Gi-Oh! Like, when you think of a Yu-Gi-Oh! Protagonist, what's the sort of thing that you think of that encapsulates a Yu-Gi-Oh! Protagonist?
I'm not sure, but when I think of Vrains, I imagine it sounds a lot like Vrains, and I imagine Yu-Gi-Oh! Being in a zombie apocalypse, which would probably be better than Vrains.
I mean, so the game itself, and the VR game is called, like, Vrains, so every time they're logging into the game, they're like, into the Vrains! And it's really lame. Oh, was that, thank you, Dizzy.
My also, gosh, that, the, what?
Oh, you haven't seen anything yet, look at this.
Look at that. Look how bad that looks. All that I like purple and everything, but the color palette for Vrains is so bad.
No, it's not even that. It's like, look at the city. It's like dead, it's derelict, there's like this gray sky.
But that's
and then
point.
In the middle of the screen you have this weird man in a jumpsuit with crazy Pokemon hero hair and just skating through the city like Sonic the Hedgehog in City Escape.
Dizzy, this is like 80% of the show you're showing me right here.
This is like a parody, but with no humor.
That is exactly
what this looks like.
Okay, so like the first core of the first arc of the show, like this is what most of like the duels look like. It's Yusaku or some other person like skating on top of like this purple data storm thing with a bunch of gray buildings behind them and uninteresting monsters and uninteresting like battles happening at the same time. And this is like majority of the show for the first core.
Does every character in this anime have at least 4 hair colors?
Apparently not. I don't know what
I'd say at least three.
I just posted this picture.
Okay, 4 is only reserved for protagonist status.
Yeah.
Now, this person has 3 hair colors, but I was going to say, like, I posted a picture just now of, like, main character person seemingly stuck in a shitty tornado.
By the way, his name is Yusaku, but his online handle is Playmaker.
He's grabbing this, he's got this ninja lady, and it's like, I'm looking at this picture, and for some reason, and I know it's like, haha, it's because you're a guy, but it's like, my eyes are just, the only thing in this picture I can see is just, wow, this woman has some big boobs. I think it's because everything else is so horrible that just 2 circles is the most interesting part of this whole picture.
2 circles is the most interesting part of any picture.
That's fair.
It's like I'm trying to look at this main character, man, and he's got like a green jumpsuit with random black lines through it. His hair is like golden with red with a purple strike, and then he's grabbing this lady in midair who has like a diving suit on with fingerless gloves, with wristbands, with stockings, with a strap around one leg, with a yellow belt buckle, and she's got a nice pair of tits. And I'm like, like that, and I'm looking at that, and I'm like, yeah, all I see of this picture, the only thing that registered was boobs. Everything else is just nonsense.
Well, yeah. Welcome back to Yu-Gi-Oh! In a landfill. I summon demonetize in defense position.
It's sort of weird, because since they're in this whole, like...
Can we slash that from the record, by the way? Because I forgot we were recording.
because we're in a VR world...
No, it was
world,
great!
Yeah, because we're in a VR world, this game, like, for some reason, the design team thought it was a good idea to over-design their characters for I mean, and it makes sense.
Overdesigning characters in an anime where two characters are already typically overdesigned.
Yeah, I know. But, like, I'm talking about, like, taking the overdesign to, like, a whole nother level.
Oh, my like, God.
Like, where they don't have to be realistic with the hair colors, or they don't have to be realistic with the... Oh, yeah, that's Blue Angel.
What is this, and where does it start, and where does it end?
Okay, so this character's name is Blue Angel. Her name.
She's Hatsune Miku.
Yeah, I mean, no.
She's Hatsune Miku's bastard daughter.
Okay, if you want to be fair, that was probably the inspiration they went for her, because the whole conceit of her character is that she's sort of like the idol of Vrains. She's like related to one of the higher ups that in the company that made Vrains, and she's like one of the best duelists, and she's also got an incredibly broken deck, at least when the show, like when the deck first came out, which is a high burn, high damage deck. So
she's terrible. This is the worst thing I've ever seen in my life. I'm going to die.
Actually,
now.
This I like this design a lot more than the other designs I've seen.
I mean, it is still incredibly over-designed, but it's still one of the better design characters in the show.
No.
Oh, by the way, Dizzy, look up Go Inazuka.
Let me explain something. This is a poorly designed character. This is the worst designed character because the other character's clothing and appearance does not constitute design.
You know what?
Yikes!
Fair. That is a fair take.
Like your friend here, your idol girl here. She's poorly designed. This guy? This is not a clothing. That's not clothes.
Yeah, oh, Soulburner's the best character. I mean, I've told you about Soulburner's ass, which is the best character in the show.
That is not clothing. Yeah. That is not clothing. What else is there?
So Soulburner's probably like the story about Soulburner is that he comes in the second season of Vrange, which is like in episode 50 something, and he's got like the biggest, most interesting personality in the entire show, kind of overshadows everybody else because he's actually an interesting character.
This is not clothing.
I'm not saying it's yeah.
This is not design. This is nonsense. Okay, that's clothing. It's poor clothing.
I actually like this Soulburner guy's design.
Yeah, Soulburner's design, like, the colors work together. That's like,
I'm not a huge fan of the aqua blue and navy blue hair.
Yeah. But Soulburner's like the most kind of normal designed character in this entire thing, and that's saying something.
I feel like if his main hair part were, if the top part was orange and the bottom part was black, that would make this character's design so much better.
Yeah. Did you just share a map of Vrain's,
I was gonna
Dizzy?
Ask you if that's what that was.
Yeah, none of this matters because the locations in the show don't make any sense. Most of the time, everything looks the same. So right. You never have any sense of where you actually are. The show's a mess. It wants to shoehorn in all these, like, different, like, elemental concepts because... I guess I should, kind of explain the plot of Vrains. So,
I'm just wondering if the stupid Yu-Gi-Oh! TV show manga dumbass ideas that I came up with as a kid are more compelling than Vrains.
Okay, so let me explain the plot to you guys.
Oh boy. Okay.
So I'll talk about season one-ish first, just because that makes... Because season two is such a mess, I don't even know if there's like a real plot I can say about
there's
it. There's
already
so
more than one season of Vrains.
Yeah, we're almost nearing episode 100. 100, but that's beside the point.
Hey, so Vrains.
Damn!
So, Yusaku, the main character, also known as Playmaker. When he was like, I would say, like elementary or intermediate school or whatever, it was probably, I forget exactly, he was like probably between like 5 and 10 or a bit, maybe a bit older, middle school, I don't give a shit. He was kidnapped by this organization and forced into these, like, these VR duels. And he and, like, a bunch of other kids were like trapped for a good amount of time in these like VR duels.
Great.
Where they had to keep fighting these.
Yeah, I forgot about that, the child soldier thing in goddamn Yu-Gi-Oh.
So what they ended up doing, like what was the whole plan of the kidnapping, is that they were dueling these AIs that were learning from them, and it was the shape, like the end goal was to create these AIs with perfect like intelligence, like it was like a true AI.
Mm-hmm.
So first off, don't question how abducting a bunch of kids and forcing them to duel creates artificial intelligence. That's beside the point.
I was going to say, there's like a thing on Vsauce that I watched about like a machine that you change its algorithm every time it plays a game so that it can eventually become perfect at playing the game.
Oh, yeah, that was on Vsauce too, right?
Yeah, but the thing... excuse me. Think about that game, though,
bless
and
you.
The diagram Vsauce too, thank you, is that you were playing a game with a very limited number of moves. Yu-Gi-Oh! Is a game with, like, a million moves.
Yeah.
Plus,
children
are not very good at Yu-Gi-Oh! You'll notice at most of the big conventions that the big players are, like, men in their 30s or 40s.
Yeah. But
you're not going to make
it's
a
not that they were
AI
trying to make, okay,
beating up children.
The goal wasn't to make dueling AI, like, AI that are really good at dueling. It was to make actual, like, artificial intelligence that actually has intelligence.
Oh, well, in that case, I have no idea what you're talking about anymore.
Yeah, so, and surprisingly, it was successful. They created a bunch of artificial intelligence that are, like, kind of like mirrors of each of these people.
They didn't make artificial intelligence, they just cloned their brains.
It's not really clones because like they have their own personality. It's more like the artificial intelligence learned from them, and it's not like a direct copy of the data.
I would love to imagine that because they abducted these kids, they finally make like artificial intelligence, and the artificial intelligence just starts crying at them to let them go.
That's great.
Guys, I'm gonna interrupt you for a moment. For this map that Dizzy posted, I'm noticing that for each of the elements, there's like a big tower, and for some reason, the wind tower is just the Eye of Sauron.
I don't know what any of that has to do with anything.
Continue. That's a tower inside of a disc tower.
Yeah. So what ends up happening is that
the dark sign tower?
I don't know. So after the after the kids are released, at some point the AI break free and they go create their own little world in the network, which I don't know how it was never found. Because part of the plot is like in the first core is trying to find the Cyverse world. That's what it's called, like the Cyverse world. But each of the AIs that are created have an element attached to them. You have, and the first one you meet is who is the Dark One, who teams up with Yusaku.
Psst.
And
nobody tell any of the Vrain's main characters that there's like a super, literally a field spell card made to just totally lock out element themed decks.
Yeah,
there's a field spell card that nullifies specific elements.
But like all the major players that have the AIs have element themed decks, so yeah, they're pretty much fucked. But so we have I, the dark themed one, and his name's I because he's an AI, and that's just what they name him.
Wonderful,
brilliant.
I was actually talking with my wife earlier because AI is such a cool thing in Japan, like as a word, because they have the word I, which means like, well, as love, and I is also a name over there. So having the acronym, having it shortened down to AI, actually works in Japanese. It doesn't translate over to English, so it doesn't matter over
should
here.
Should have called him Kuroyami.
That's too real. But so for the first core, we basically have first season, you have Yugi. I wish it was Yugi. You have Playmaker, who's Yusaku. And I trying to defeat these guys called the Knights of Hanoi, based off the Tower of Hanoi, which is a plot device later.
Is this going to be on the test?
Yes, it's going to be on the test. So the Knights of Hanoi are trying to go around and find all these elemental AIs and destroy them all because they're because they believe they're inherently evil. And that kind of makes sense because the guy who founded the Knights of Hanoi is also the guy who created the AI and was the one who abducted all these kids.
He adopted them, but they called it an abduction.
Abducted. Well, it's abduction. I said abducted. I meant to say word vomit. So, I guess another...
Stop doing that, Trey. This is a problem.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm a big ol' freaking monster over here. Anyways, another important person, like, because Yusuku can't really do this all by himself. He has some friend who works at a hot dog stand named Jin, whose brother was another one of the victims from the incident of
Is that
the abduction.
Why a lot of the Google image pictures that I was looking up had your blue-haired main character eating hot dogs?
Yeah. Yeah, because he works part time at the hot dog stand with Jin, and Jin helps him out on recon missions.
I was curious about that because I just saw a lot of pictures of him eating hot dogs, and I was like, huh?
Oh, it's all sexual. Don't worry, it's all there to for the fangirls.
But he eats them with the bun on.
Yeah, I know, kinky, right?
No, that's how you know it's not sexual though. That's like that's hot dog code. Yeah. Hot dog code is eat just the hot dog. It's sexual. Eat it with the bun. It's just food.
Not in Vrains.
Vrains may understand the Yu-Gi-Oh meta, but it does not understand hot dog language.
So, but anyways, the only important thing with Jin right now is that his brother is an important character in the second season, and I don't even know if I'm going to talk about that because it's a mess.
I just remembered the recording.
Yeah. So
episode I've ever been on.
So all you need to know about the first season is that the three main characters of the first season are Yusuku, Blue Angel, and Go Inazuka.
Do they make friends with Ai?
No one really makes friends with Ai. Everybody just kind of hit.
Ai is kind of like our Kaiba or our Chaz, correct?
Well, no, Ai is kind of like
Does he die?
What? No, I didn't die.
Damn it. I was going to say, because at the start of every Yu-Gi-Oh season, it's always, ha, I'm the dude that's going to be your enemy, and we're going to become rivals, and then we're going to become friends.
No, I's the partner. I's more closer to something like Yubel or Wing Karibo.
Oh. Wing Karibo starts as your friend, though.
Yeah, I know. No, I starts as your friend. No, Yusuku does. Yusuku is just kind of like Yandere without the dere. No, you know, he's Tsundere. He's just Yusuke
he's
is very
Yandere
soon.
Without the Yandere. He just wants to kill. He has no love. He's just a psychopath. I'll kill everyone for me.
Yusuke is very soon. He's very shut off, traumatized, cold hearted.
Really, he does not come across like that at all in any of these pictures. But
yeah,
then again,
because
he has a very blank face.
Yeah, no, he always has a blank face all the time. It's just when he's Playmaker, he's angry. When he's Yusuku, he's just emotionless.
I like to imagine hey, Yusuku, are you Playmaker?
Okay.
And he's like, how did you know? And it's like, I recognized your face. And he's like, that's
self
wear a mask.
So I guess, okay, so Yusuke's character, the reason why he's Playmaker is because he wants to get revenge for the abduction and also revenge because Jin's brother was abducted. He just wants to get his revenge on Knights of Hanoi. So he kind of has this Batman-like persona as Playmaker. And
yeah, Batman.
Yeah, so I was explaining this to my wife. What makes Batman interesting, so most of the, when Batman's in his Batman form, depending on the interpretation, let's say with the Dark Knight series, the Dark Knight Batman, 90% of the time is just angry, bitter, resentful, dark voice, edgy as fuck, but okay, that's a good one. Is Yu-Gi-Oh! Vrange the new Sword Art Online?
No,
bitch, please. I'd rather watch Sword Art Online again for the fourth time.
Oh, yikes!
Because I hate myself. But what makes Bruce Wayne and Batman interesting is that Bruce Wayne is kind of the polar opposite. He's a very suave, cool, puts on these, even if he's putting on an act to those around him, there's more to him than just the anger. Where with Yusuku, it's all that there is with him is the anger. And maybe for a season or two, that's okay. After 90 episodes, when it's nothing but, oh, I'm anger, cool, edgy, whatever, and I have no other personality, which basically every character in Vrains boils down to one archetypal personality and no other, well, nothing else.
I was going to say, like, I don't know what Vrains is trying to do, but from how it's described, it seems like it's trying to be, like, mostly like a typical shonen anime, but the main character wants revenge instead of to fight or just to be with his friends or some shit. Mm-hmm. And it's like, there are plenty of very good examples of stories with protagonists who are just super angry, but it seems like from what you're describing, Yusuku being angry all the time is not, it's like his only character.
Yeah.
And yet it's not utilized well.
Well, he's either angry or not angry. That's his two personality types. Personalities.
I was being described a movie, or I was told about a movie that apparently was super, super popular over in the East. And I'm not going to say what the movie was, but it was a revenge movie. And again, like, you have a main character that's, like, super, super angry, like, all the time and stuff. And he's, like, doing really destructive things. But he's not really portrayed as, like, a good guy. And he even says himself that he's not really a good person and that he's kind of obsessed and he knows it. And it's like with Yusuku, it from what you're describing, it sounds like he's just mad. But that's where it ends. It starts with, I'm mad and I want revenge. And that's where it ends. They don't go further. They don't say it's a bad thing he's mad. They don't say it's a good thing he's mad. He's not constructive with his anger. That's just what he is.
Well, there's no nuance or anything interesting with his character.
I've been looking at this picture for a while, and it totally looks like Playmaker has four fingers.
Oh my god, it does, because it's a really bad angle.
I didn't see it until you pointed it out to me.
Oh my god, that makes it immediately 100 times better. You have to watch Vrains now. Vrains, 10 out of 10, because Yusuku has four fingers.
One shot.
So, actually, speaking of the characters and, like, Yusuku being very one note, well, I guess technically two notes, but two very uninteresting notes. There's another character in the show I was talking about, Going Nezuka. He's the one that got the...
His two notes are A and A flat. Yeah.
So Going Nezuka is like the very blocky looking guy, with the very square face, like a rectangular face. And the yellow and the...
Yeah, like the armor that only protects his abs.
Yeah. So, Go is probably, at least in the first season, is probably the most nuanced and interesting character. He's an interesting, nuanced, and flawed character. He's probably the best part of the first season. Keyword, first season. So, Go's whole
shtick... Because then Mr. Flamey Boy shows up and steals the show.
Well, that has nothing to do with that. They just mishandle Go's character to completion because they completely missed the point of his character. Also, because they're juggling so many plot points in the second season and so many characters the second season that nobody gets enough time to actually shine, so that when people have their like character arc moments, it's like it comes out of nowhere. It's like, well, this seems out of character because we haven't seen this character in like 2 months. So Go's character, he's a wrestler. A professional wrestler sort of character. You're masked.
He's a heel.
He's not the heel. Okay, I'll get to that. So, Go's shtick is that he grew up in an orphanage, and he was adopted out of the orphanage by like somebody with money, and he became a wrestler. But he wrestles to entertain the kids at the orphanage. He still helps out at the orphanage, and he's kind of like this big brother mentor character to them.
Okay.
And he's like, when the story starts, he's the strongest duelist in Vrains. He's has never lost a duel before. He's very
So this is our Kaiba character.
Yeah, I mean really Revolver's the Kaiba character, but this is like you're more like, at least in the start, like he's in Vrains, he's a better analogous to Kaiba, but he doesn't serve the same narrative purpose. Okay. Well, I guess Revolver's kind of like America almost, but I don't know how to just, I guess Revolver might be, I don't know, ignore me. So he's kind of like the Kaiba.
Let me ask you another question then. Mm-hmm. Like, number one, well, actually, let me ask you two questions. Number one, like, How, like, you say, like, aside from wanting revenge, like, are most of these heroes in, like, Vrains, like, pretty, like, socially well? When I say socially well, I mean, like, they're the heroes, they do the good thing, they go to the school, they don't skip the class, they're not the delinquents, or they are the delinquents,
School.
but they're the delinquents that beat up the other delinquents and skip
I would
school to save the
argue.
world and shit.
Well, it's kind of weird you mentioned it. I want to get back because this kind of plays into, Vrain. Well, get back into the ghost story because it feels like they wanted to tell a more nuanced, mature story with a bunch of more adult characters with flaws rather than this big bombastic shonen fest that older like Yu-Gi-Oh. Yu-Gi-Oh is ten well tends to be like it feels like it's a very much the opposite of Arc Fee, where Arc Fee is this big, colorful, very expressive, shonen sort of show, where even though it does have like characters with flaws, it's got a very flawed main character. It don't like it like Vrain, Arc V is a much more emotional heavy show, where I feel like Vrain's t is trying to be a bit more a mature and introspectful sh kind of show. And I don't think the writers are capable of writing that sort of show, at least on the time strain, like whatever situation they are in writing this show. And I Go Inuzuka is the best example of this. So as I said, he's like this wrestler who wrestles to entertain orphanage kids. After he duels Playmaker and loses, this kind of sets off this little thing in him where he's like. I guess the Kaiba mentality. It's like I'm the best duelist. I've never lost. He's taking the loss very badly, and he takes multiple opportunities to try to beat Yusuke afterwards. And at the end of the first season, he faces off against the big bad well the main bad guy of that season, Revolver, who's trying to wipe out the entire network, which would basically kill everybody that's inside the network at the time and disrupt all electronics within the city limits.
And wouldn't that also
But
kill himself?
yes, he's willing to kill himself just to erase all the AI because he believes the AI is such a bad in the world. He's willing to kill himself, everybody who's still logged into the network, and potentially hundreds of people within the city. But that's another
Well,
conversation.
that just seems weird because, like, all you've told me about this guy is that he duels
Well, no,
for
no.
fun and to entertain
Oh no,
children, and
this
now
is
you're saying he's a
Revolver.
big
Okay,
sore
no,
loser?
oh no,
No,
no.
this is a
Okay,
different
sure.
dude.
Okay,
Oh, this is
so
a
okay,
different
so.
dude.
Okay, no. I think we're getting two people mixed up. So
Yeah.
Revolver, the bad guy, is trying to kill all the AIs.
Okay.
Go Inuzuka is somebody who's never lost a duel. He's always been like the top dog, and he's been dueling for entertainment for these kids. And once he loses against Yusuke, it kind of sets him off in this character. You'd expect you'd almost expect it to be like, oh, he's struggling handling the loss because he's never lost before. He lost in front of he lost in front of the kids that look up to him. Like, he's no longer the big hero that he was. So to an extent, it kind of shows he wasn't just doing this for the kids, he was doing it for his own ego. And that I do like that inherent flaw in him and that character study that they start to do. But it starts to go a bit downhill with his duel against Revolver, because what ends up happening is he loses the duel to Revolver, but he also kind of un like he his duel with a Revolver, which allows Yusuke to figure out Revolver's weakness. So technically speaking, Yusuke would have never beat Revolver if it wasn't for Go. So that's an important thing to remember. Then, as the show goes into the second season, also I guess within this arc over here with this whole shutting down a network arc, Go takes a temporary heel turn for a single duel and then turns back. I don't remember the context for it. It was kind of dumb, but some of the cards were cool. So in the second season, Go kind of drops the whole drops the whole he's a wrestler persona, and the whole orphanage thing's kind of forgotten as he the corporation that owned well that created Vrains wants to collect all the AIs so they can do research on them. And Go gets hired by them to become a bounty hunter to beat Yusuke, well, be Playmaker and collect the rest of the AIs.
So, is he
So,
teaming up with Yusuke to catch Playmaker?
No, Yusuke is playmaker.
I know, but that's why I'm wondering. Is it like an ironic situation where it's like...
Oh, no. Yusuke's not attached to like any of the...
Well, of course, Yusuke has to not love anyone so he can be the edgelord.
Yep. Well, because Yusuke wants to protect the AI, but he's also kind of just using the AI to figure out... Well, the second season, as I said, is a mess because he can't lose the AI because... Or the AI can't be destroyed because... Jin's brother's consciousness gets stolen by the AI that was created by Jin's brother.
What?
Okay, so at the start of the second season, digital thing.
This reminded me a lot of Digimon Cyber Sleuth, but somehow even worse.
Yeah, that's exactly what Vrains is. So in the second season of Vrains, it kind of starts off by cutting to Jin's brother in the hospital because he's been emotionally damaged to such an extent from the he has so much trauma and PTSD, he's just kind of like living in a hospital now.
Just erase his memories. That worked for the main characters of I'm not gonna go there.
This data thing comes out of the TV in Jin's brother's room.
Oh no, stuff it back in. We don't want any percent of four in here.
And then steals Jin's consciousness and pulls it into the digital world.
Oh no, it's an eater. Stuff it back in. We don't want any Digimon Cyber Sleuth here.
Anyways, Jin's in a coma. Yusuke and Jin's brother's in a coma. Yusuke and Jin's like, shit, we have to go figure this out. And it starts, puts them into the, like the 60 episode arc of which we're currently 60 on.
Episode. Holy
yeah, this
crap.
This whole arc has been longer than the first arc of. The first season, like this has been like going on for 60, 70 episodes so far.
Golly.
Because there's so many characters and so much bullshit.
We gotta go save Kirie. Come on, like, Nero.
The Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Monsters, like the Duelist Kingdom arc was only like 50 episodes long.
You know, in the original Yu-Gi-Oh! Number one, it took place on Earth. Number two, like that was a story about a high schooler trying to save his grandfather, who was basically his legal guardian, and another high schooler trying to save his freaking like little brother. It was a story about like kidnapping and like really horrible stuff, blackmail, death threats, just all kinds of like cheating, big professional stuff, big unprofessional stuff. Yami Yugi almost got killed with flamethrowers. Like people almost got shot. Yami Bakura definitely killed someone. And it's like, that show is made for kids to teenagers.
Yeah.
It's like...
But, Vrains has none of this intrigue. It's mostly just people dueling.
Vrains, like, I have no proof of this because I have not watched Vrains, but it feels super tryhard because every Yu-Gi-Oh! Season has had, like, really dark and super edgy stuff. But it's like... This just sounds too far, like, to the part, like it was already laughable when in Yu-Gi-Oh! 5Ds, the world gets screwed because too much dueling happened and it started the robot apocalypse. That was silly. Yu-Gi-Oh! Vrains is like, oh no. Like,
okay,
we start with child, like, slavery and stuff and child soldier stuff. No. I'm like, nope.
I actually want to stop you there because I feel like they're not trying at all with Vrains.
They're not trying at all.
Like, I feel like they're so confident with, like, it feels like they're so confident in their story, like, or confident in the like this whole mature thing. Like, oh, we're trying to be more like the adults Yu-Gi-Oh, where we're taking this seriously. This isn't a joke. We're taking this seriously. This is a bunch of serious stuff happening, and we're gonna examine it and we're gonna talk about it. And it's not going to be fun, but in the end, it's going to be important story. It feels like they're trying to write an important story about AI and the relationships between AI humans, and the dangers that could come about if we don't handle it properly. There's no there's no fun in Vrains, where the try hard edginess and the in previous Yu-Gi-Oh! Seasons were so over the top and try-hardy in that sense that it's like it was fun. Where in here it's just like you watch an episode and you'd be like, what? Never in my life in Yu-Gi-Oh! Okay, so I'm someone who really enjoys these sorts of these like game sorts of like these like competition-based shows where you have like people competing against each other. I kind of like sports animes. I think Yu-Gi-Oh! Is what's got me into it. Like I love watching the duels. I love seeing the interaction between the people and like, oh, the big reveal of how it's gonna win. It tickles a bone. Like it tickles something in my body that I just enjoy.
The feeling someone's gonna. I'm not going there.
Yeah,
I'm not going there. I'd
I can't
remember it on
tell.
recording.
I can't tell you how many times I zoned out in a Vrains duel.
See,
Because.
'cause this just sounds like Yu-Gi-Oh! Brain sounds like going to high school. You walk in, it's you see things get blurry, and then suddenly it's the end of the day, and you walk home.
Yeah, I mean that's basically it. Anyways, back to the ghost stuff. Back to the ghost stuff, because I'm gonna just show you how like, because this actually kind of, this is like the most try-hardy edgy thing that they did in the show. So okay, last time I left
I
off
thought
with
the most try-hardy edgy thing in the show was the protagonist.
I thought the most
No,
try-hardy edgy thing in the show
no,
was
just wait, just
try.
wait for, just wait for it, just wait for it, because it was this was something that was that if it didn't ruin Go's character, it would have been like the greatest, most hilarious thing they did in the show.
Please tell me he kills someone with a gun.
I wish.
Like
I wish.
someone's having a conversation, they're like, "Go, you ruined this." And then he just whips out a gun, apropos of nothing, bang, headshot, like roses. Just everything is silent. The person just falls off whatever giant skyscraper they're on, and just like, no! And like doves fly. Just. The sun sets, just. And the person just falls off the building. You never see their face. And just. That'd be great, actually.
At
I'd
this
love
point,
that.
God, dizzy. So at this point, I've already established that he's joined up with the corporation, and the only reason why he's done this is because he's so consumed with beating like Yusaku because of his ego that he's purposely put himself in opposition of Yusaku just to be able to fight him and beat him.
All right, this makes a modicum of sense so far.
So we've gone from the sympathetic character who's kind of almost become irredeemable because he kind of joined.
I was
Because
gonna
he
say,
kind of joined, he's kind of joined one of the worst like organization, like he, because it's a terrible organization. If you,
this
if
reminds
you,
me of Vegeta, actually, when he like purposefully got brainwashed so he could get stronger, and
yeah,
then he
but
just
Vegeta was a,
murders a bunch of people so that Goku will fight him.
but Vegeta started off as a bad guy. Like, Vegeta always had this air of evilness in him, or this air of like ego and self-centeredism, and
Yeah, but
like
he was
he's.
getting better.
But
And
the point is like
he even openly says that he hates that he was getting better and he wanted to be evil.
and that's still that's stupid. I know, but at least with Vegeta, we've like it was established that he was evil before.
Yeah.
With Go, he started off as a really sympathetic, great, flawed character who didn't have a shred of badness in him. Like he was a very charitable person who helped take care of this organization. They've almost played up this angelicness of Go despite his ego. Like he's inherently a good person, but he's thrown all that away for his revenge against Yusaku so he can finally beat Yusaku.
Well, I can, I'm
I was
understanding it
expecting
better.
more to this story.
So
See,
no, just wait.
okay, there is more.
So
Well, hold
let me
on,
just continue.
because I was
So
gonna say
after
like,
let me
I was gonna say like, now Go is reminding me of someone else. But I can't remember who that someone else was. And that's all I was gonna say.
So,
You go ahead.
oh gosh, that actually took up
so,
all audacity.
so I'm not like him wanting to get revenge against Yusaku and finally beat Yusaku for his own ego isn't a terrible way to take the story as long as they find ways to address it and if there's some way if they're actually addressing that goes wrong for doing this outside of like in his like, if I don't know. Anyways. So after losing to Yusaku again, okay, I'm sorry.
They're
This
like,
is
get on with that.
okay. This is so stupid. Okay, this is so stupid. Okay, so the corporate like he signs up for this like this experiment in the corporation where they implant a chip in his brain with an AI inside it.
Aren't they
Oh,
trying to get rid of
is
all
that
the
this?
AIs?
Is that
Yeah. Well,
this?
it's these specific AIs. It's like it's not all artificial intelligence. These specific artificial intelligence, which are like perfect artificial
Hold
intelligences.
on.
So, oh God. So,
Oh.
So that was when he did his heel turn in the first season. And that was just all just he did that for attention to for the he did that for attention for the orphanage kids. He put it was like more of showmanship in a sense. But it was stupid. Anyways, back to the AI. So they implant the chip in his brain with the AI, and there's this like thing where like he's like merging with the AI. He has a duel against one of the he has a duel against the Earth element that, right? AI, and it is hard for me to explain this without you seeing for yourself. But essentially, this surgery and all the like and all these tests that he's doing to merge with the AI has what?
Can we take a quick stop for a minute? I need to make sure that conversation didn't come up in the record.
What conversation?
The one I was just having with someone.
Okay. I mean, you can always remove it from the audacity.
Well, I guess that's true. You know what? I've lost it already.
Anyways, as I was like, okay, the wait's over. The commercial break has been passed. I will finally tell you why this is so stupid. So Go is so obsessed.
It only took 30 minutes.
I know. So Go is so obsessed with beating Yusaku that he goes through all these tests that physically decimate and wither him. At the start of the show, you see he's very buff. He's very strong. He looks like a pro wrestler. When you see him again, and remember, this is a very like abrupt change for the show. It's not like oh. One episode, he's like, okay, I'm signing up for this. The next episode, like, a few episodes pass and whatnot. No, this is very abrupt, and you have all these other character stories going on. He is fucking withered to the bone. He looks like a dying man. And he's, like, mentally incapable, like, mentally insane. He's gone off the deep end. And he's not even, like, the same character we met at the start of the show. Which isn't inherently a bad thing. But
the execution involved with this was super shoddy.
Yep. Especially this kind of goes into the whole theme of the show where all the problems with the character arcs come from is that they're telling so many stories and so many character arcs that are not interconnected that you end up not seeing these shows for 5-10 episodes. Well, these characters are 5-10 episodes on end. So they suddenly come back and they're like, oh, I'm having this change. When last time you saw them, they were already having some sort of change.
So you're saying it's like supposed to be the story of the hero turning villain, but instead it's just the hero going insane and then spiraling downward for no real reason.
Yeah, exactly.
For petty, it was for petty ego, wasn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
You say it's for petty ego, but at this point, it just sounds like the guy is completely unstable.
Yeah,
like,
no,
I'm not even. I don't even think it was ego from the way you've described it. It sounds like he's just not right in the head.
But
like,
it's
I
funny,
lost
it's
a card game. My new life purpose is to end you.
Yeah, essentially.
Like,
but at the beginning of the show, there was no inclination of this unstableness. Like, yeah, okay, there was a bit of like, oh, this he has this ego in regards to like, oh, I'm the best, I'm the top dog. Whatever, but there is like no inclination that he was capable of going down this route.
He reminds me of Gaston from Shin Megami Tensei 4 Final, except Gaston was better, and I didn't even like Gaston that much. But he's kind of like Vegeta in that he starts out like arrogant and like really snooty and prideful, and then like that image gets shattered and stuff, mm-hmm. and he does some stuff that's less than favorable. But then it's like with this guy, it's like, no, he starts out like it's this is like if Sonic the Hedgehog suddenly like became Sephiroth.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah,
never really. That did not come across at all.
Yeah. And it's not like it couldn't have worked, but we don't spend enough time with these characters to be able to form these connections or to get to know the characters well enough to believe these transitions.
Try, I want to ask you something, and it's going to make Tar very angry.
Oh, boy.
Now, there's definitely a better term for this, but I don't know what the term is, so I call it DSY's Persona 5 problem, which is, it always ties back to Persona 5, doesn't it?
Of course.
But one of my big problems with something that I don't know if I've talked about it very much on this show, is that a lot of what annoys me about Persona 5 is that it's not even that they had bad ideas, it's that they did them so poorly. And I'm asking you, is Vrains like that, or is it just awful?
No,
like,
no.
Do you look at Vrains and think this? Do you look at like a lot of stuff in Vrains and say this pisses me off not just because it didn't work, but because it could have worked? Or do you look at this and say this is a travesty?
Okay. Vrains is abundant with great ideas. None of the character arcs none of the characters are inherently bad ideas. They're all interesting things, like interesting ideas to explore, study. But to the same extent, they're almost too interesting. You want to delve into these characters' histories, their backstories, their mental psyches, know why they're making these decisions. But instead, it's like, oh, this character loses a duel. 10 episodes later, you get to see what happened to them after they lost that duel.
So, yeah, that's always... that's really frustrating to me, because I don't know if I could watch... I don't know if I could watch Vrains now if you're telling me, like, you watched the show and you kept going, like, this could have worked.
Yeah, no.
But it didn't. Because just pissed me off. I would go crazy.
So let me do the obvious some comparison. So... Sword Art Online is a show I have frequently have stated as a criticism in the past. Maybe not on the show, but I think I've done it on one episode. My biggest problem with Sword Art Online is that it's a great idea handled poorly.
Mm-hmm.
But Sword Art Online's concept is great. The rest of the ideas in the show are terrible.
Whereas here Vrains, is the inverse. Like, the concept is awful, but there are so many cool ideas within the concept that were completely mishandled.
Exactly.
Those are always the worst.
It's the most boilerplate concept. Oh, let's have Yu-Gi-Oh, but it's in VR, which is kind of silly considering that we kind of already had that as AR in fucking Zexal.
What and the then, fuck is that monster name?
Dino Wrestler King. Oh, that's Goz.
Dino Wrestler King T Wrestles Attack.
Go had one of the most eccentric decks because like his deck was like called the Dino Wrestlers, and there are a bunch of dinosaurs that were wrestlers.
Amazing.
I'm just waiting for the super super like muscle men deck. It just makes everyone so angry.
And
then to just make all of the jokes about like all the you know jokes, and at the end of the duel he's like, "What are you talking about?" Like just the duel is just full of innuendos. But then at the end the guy's like, "What are you talking about? I was serious," because he was never explicitly saying things; he was just implying things. And then it's like, "I wasn't implying anything. That's just how I talk." And then they go, "Oh, ha ha, we thought you were gay." And then it's like the credits roll, and then everyone gets angry.
I've actually just come to like think of something. Tar, Dizzy, let me ask you: if you were to write a story in VR, how would you go about designing it? What sort of restrictions would you pull on yourself, or would you not put any restrictions on yourself, or would you...
I would write the story first, and then I would make the setting to accommodate it.
Fuck if I know!
But I'm just talking about let me frame the question this way. From an aesthetic place, would you, if you're making a VR game, would you make it a really grungy, like a very bland-looking city that no one would want to, be in?
If I was making a VR game, not like a show or something.
Yeah, if you were making a VR game, what's
I see. That
would depend on my limitations within the limitations of my abilities within the software.
Let me just assume that what you mean by that is something akin to Sword Art Online or Vrains, in the idea of you plug yourself into this world and you have limitless resources to make it however you want. That's what you're asking, right?
Yeah, that's essentially what let's say you're writing you're writing a story or you're making VR games, and the idea is that you have no limitations on what you can make.
Yeah, see, in that case, like, I would want to create something that you would not see in real life. Like, I would want to make like a space alien world, or like the deep oceans, or a parallel real world esque kind of setting that's definitely something like Mass Effect, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because you can see real life. You can just look outside your window.
I have no fucking clue.
Video games.
Like, just why? Like, from the design team of the show, they had they could have made anything for the VR world,
and they made a city.
The real world is more interesting looking than the VR world.
You know what? I was going to tell you, actually. While I was looking at Google Images, I was noticing that when main character man was normal, things looked visually better.
Yeah. Okay. Want to know what the most interesting set piece in the entire show is?
Is it the park?
Oh, boy.
Tar, take a guess.
You can't guess park because I already did.
Yeah.
I have no clue where to even try to guess.
Is it the
fucking hot dog stand?
Dang it, I should have guessed that.
I should have guessed that too. I forgot that it existed.
That is the most interesting looking set piece. Because in the VR world, it's either you're in a grungy city or you're in some generic elemental area that has no defining qualities other than the fact that it's of this element. Like, yeah, it's the water stage, it's a beach. Or, oh, it's the grass stage, there's grass. Or, oh, it's the light stage, it's some generic palace that's light. It's the wind stage, there's wind!
I was gonna say, oh, dang, you know what? Oh, my goodness, you're right. And it's like, you know what? I think I was gonna say that, actually, like, tries. Like, Vrains is so weird to me for a variety of reasons I don't even know if I can properly explain. Because I'm, like, half awake. But it's like... Are you guys still there? Guys?
Fucking show.
Actually, if Dizzy's gonna cut out like this...
Am I cutting out?
I couldn't hear what you were saying.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was thinking about something with Vrains, and I wasn't sure if I could properly explain it, but it's like...
Oh, wait, like, were you just not talking then?
No, I was talking. You'll have to check my Audacity. Try might even have to cut it from the record since I might be talking over you guys. I'm talking right now. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Yeah,
I am talking right now. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes, we hear you.
What I was going to say is that looking at some pictures of Yu-Gi-Oh! Vrains where they're outside of the Vrains world, it's like you have a world that looks fairly normal. And as a result, the weird characters and their silly hair stand out a lot more as they juxtapose against a world that seems fairly normal. And because the world seems fairly normal, like you have your school and your park and your hot dog stand, like I get like this picture I just posted of your main character sitting at the hot dog stand. That is like the most invested I have been in this show this whole time. Like, because this is just something that people do. It just looks like. It just looks so right. It just looks so normal. It makes it look like this guy is just a normal dude, but he's not a normal dude. He's this dude that wants anger and revenge, but it's like, you know, but it's like this one picture has more like a personality than anything else I've seen, and it's a dude sitting at a hot dog stand.
Yeah,
and then
know.
It's like
something
that's fucking depressing.
No, but like
well,
that's not all.
I think the reason that the city is all bland and grungy like that is because, like, again, look at how multicolored the protagonists are. Like, they definitely want you to focus on that.
No, but like that's another problem I was gonna mention about the Vrain City. Or what did I type that in? Vrains. City into the Vrains. To the Vrains.
Do you want to know my honest opinion about why the city looks like that?
Why does the city look like that?
Because they spend 90% of the duels, like especially in the first season, flying around that city. It is much easier on the animation and cost budget if it's just plain-ass generic textures that they can reuse over and over again.
Here's the weird thing I was going to say, though.
Like, the Vrain City of just the gray blocky stuff and the boring sky and the horrible neon-colored lights and their Sonic Riders hoverboards and stuff, it's so weird to describe this because it looks like it's so low effort, and yet it's almost overstuffed. Like, I cannot focus on anything in this gray blank city, including the protagonists. It just looks like it looks so boring. Like, but here's the thing too. It not only looks boring because there's not a lot going on, there's because a lot of the colors, even the bright colors, are so like muted. There's so many colors, but they're all like dull. So
yeah,
even so,
that also makes a lot of sense.
It's
a faded yellow, a faded purple, a faded teal, a faded red.
It all bleeds together.
I was gonna say it's so weird to describe it this way, but the Vrain City looks over designed while being underdeveloped.
Over designed but under animated.
Yeah, it's so weird. It's like it looks like they just threw a paint bucket, like they just threw a bunch of paint buckets against the wall, and they're like, "There you go." And they threw the main character's paint on last so he would stand out more. But there's nothing for him to stand out against because the whole thing is a mess. And it's like, look, we made a whole bunch of colors, and that black spot in the middle is the main character. And it's that black spot in the middle didn't even register in my brain. None of these pictures registered in my brain. None of these colors registered in my brain. I look at this picture and I fall asleep.
You know, and none of this would actually matter as much if the duels themselves were inherently interesting to watch. If the monster designs were worth looking at and had interesting colors and had interesting like battle animations. Like part of what made Arc V so fun to watch is that the monsters all had these crazy colorful designs that you couldn't take your eyes off of.
Like call me stupid, but like, I just posted a picture that is a close-up of the main character and Ninja Girl with all these
Ghost
colors.
Girl?
Ninja girl.
Her name's Ghost Girl.
Ninja
Get
Ghost
right.
Girl, and there's all this green stuff, and then like this picture again, close up of main character, two humans take up the majority of this picture, and my eyes are focused on the equator in the background.
Yeah, I'm actually focused on the green buildings between them.
Yeah.
I can't. I try to look at the characters, and my eyes just go straight back to them.
I know. It's crazy. It's like there's. It's like it's so mute,
and it doesn't help that like the duel it's one thing that the monsters aren't interesting to look at. It's one thing that like the duels aren't interesting to look at in general. The duels take up a large majority of the show. You remember in old Yu-Gi-Oh where a duel could last like 2 to 3 episodes?
Yes. I thought it was 3 to 4. Maybe even five if it was the big final fight of the season.
Okay, so yeah, duels could last 2 to 5 fights depending on their importance. But there was so much character behind them. There was so much color, bombasticness. Like, it didn't matter if the duels were going on that long because they were having fun. Oh my god, fuck you, Dizzy. but in Vrains, the duels can go on for 3 episodes, and it's so unengaging. It's always the same dialogue back and forth. None of the villains have any personality. Like, one of the best part of OG Yu-Gi-Oh! And even some of the later seasons is that the villains were these big, bombastic characters that you couldn't take your eyes off of. And, like, everybody was shouting. Like, it was over the top, probably a bit too over the top at times. But
it's kind of like a question that was asked of, like, what makes a bad villain? And then, like, because a lot of times in, like, TV shows or kid shows or fighting games or all kinds of stuff, you'll have people that say, like, this villain was not very good. And then people say, dude, it's a kid show or a video game or a fighting game or something. You're not supposed to care about if the villain doesn't make sense or stuff. And it's like, you know what makes a bad villain? A boring villain. Like, Yu-Gi-Oh! Villains were insane. Let's go ahead and point at Yu-Gi-Oh! Villains for a second. You guys remember Arcana?
Oh,
guy who apparently was popular.
Arcane. That was Mr. Magician Man. That was Mr. Magician Man, right?
Mm-hmm. He had one duel and he lost it, and he was popular enough to be put in Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Links as a playable character, and both of you also remember who he was. One duel. Mm-hmm. And he lost. And it's like, versus Vrains, and it's like, Try, who was any of the bad guys?
I can just remember the bad guys because, like, one of them's named Revolver. That's the only real bad guy I can actually remember his name from.
It's like...
Okay, there's actually two bad guys I can distinctly remember from the first season. Because I'm going to say first season because the second season has some new new villains, whatnot. Revolver was the main bad guy from the season. He was kind of uninteresting. I'm going to forget him. Probably the only bad guy from the first season I'm going to remember is a guy named, I think his name was Spectre. And his whole thing was that he would basically troll the opponent and mentally, it would eventually, like, mentally traumatize them and mentally destroy them and fuck with their heads in order to win.
So he's Hazama.
Yeah, basically. And he was
because Hazama just wins. Hazama wins fights with knife boots. Fights by talking.
Well, he was this big, he was one of the kids that was abducted when he was younger. So, he's probably the most interesting villain. He's a really good duelist. He was abducted when he was a kid.
Counter to main character man.
Yeah, to some degree, he's.
Remember his name.
Yeah, Yusuke Playmaker.
Yeah, Playmaker.
But he's like he's kind of like a foil to to Playmaker to some extent. He's got like this bitter angerness at the AIs, but he's also finds this solace within Revolver, who's like the leader of these bad guys, who's also like the grandkid of either the kid or the grandkid of the guy who did the abduction to him. It's whatever.
On, you're saying this guy abducted his own grandkid?
No, his grandkid was kind of the one that called the cops and got everybody freed.
Oh, okay.
That's just funny to me.
Yeah,
I know. Hey, Grandpa, what do you keep in the basement? Oh, nothing, son. Don't go down there. Welp, Grandpa's going to sleep. And then the kid just runs to the basement, just sees the horrible, like, children dungeon and stuff. And he's like, I'm going to call the police now.
You know how a lot of, like, Yu-Gi-Oh! Villains will have, like, the big over-the-top facial animations? They're, like, the yelling.
Yeah.
The cocky confidence. I have this, like, character to them. Spectre is the only character in the entire show that has that outside of Go when he gets
when he does the heel
AI'd
turn.
Up. Yeah. Well, the true heel turn, not the fake heel turn. When Go has his true heel turn and fuses the AI, he becomes a proper Yu-Gi-Oh villain.
Oh, what the
but
heck?
It was still stupid. It didn't make sense for his character. Where Spectre is like Spectre basically gets off with messing with his opponents.
There you go. Evil villain base.
Yeah, essentially.
But, like, I was just thinking, actually, like, I just had an even sillier thought of, like, the old man who's doing the horrible, like, children test things to make the AIs, and then the grandkid gets in the basement and he sees it, and then he doesn't call the cops, and he's like talking about with a friend, just, oh yeah, like old people are weird. My grandfather keeps a bunch of kids in his basement. And all the other kids look at him like, dude, what? And he's like eating a sandwich, like, what? Isn't that normal? They're like, no. It's like, uh
oh. Oh, is this Mr. Spectre Man?
Then he calls Spectre. The police.
He only has one hair color. What is this?
Yeah, Spectre's like the best designed character in the show. It's like Spectre is unironically the best character in the show.
This is what Spectre Joey thinks of his chin.
It's just white.
I know, but isn't it great? Like how you can have just like a simple color palette, an interesting backstory, a fun personality that's. Like he you love to hate him, and yet
hang on. It's white with some black stripes.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah. But.
Vertigo. Oh.
Oh. This is not going in the show notes. Anyways, Spectre is Spectre's like the only like. Character with personality within brains that it's the only shred of fun that the show actually has.
Of fun that this show has is whenever I dunk on Dizzy.
And this has been Bros in the Landfill.
Signing off!
Oh, we're done.
I don't know. It's just a fucking shame that Spectre's only in the show for a fraction of it and then gets ridden out in the second half. I don't know if they're going to bring him back.
He gets ridden out. He doesn't even die.
Well, no, there's this whole thing in the second arc where like they're killing people, but it's more like they're absorbing their data, and some serious main characters are losing and getting their data absorbed, which makes me completely think they're going to bring them back because their character arcs aren't finished. And it would be... I don't trust that the writers would completely kill them off, especially when there's probably still a third season that's going to happen. We probably still have another, like, 40 to 50 episodes of the show left, and some of the most important characters in the show have
been... Didn't you say this arc has already gone on for 60 episodes?
Yeah, but we should be nearing a third... We should be...
this is going to be a separate arc.
Yeah. Okay. We should be nearing the end of this arc soon.
Please, it's did we ever get to what Go did?
Oh yeah, go. He fucking
We said he just like his ego consumed him and he withered away.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
See, I forgot that he didn't.
Mind, body, someone. And soul are just gone.
Yeah, he's just kind of fucked. Yeah, he fucked himself, and then he lost against Super 2 again, and then he's just all a mess.
I just hope Vrains ends with everyone in the data world dying except for the main character and the love interest who fuse into one being and then go into space to fight God, but they're teamed up with the digital data of all of their allies.
You know what would be the ultimate
dislike
irony?
Dislike this video if you got that reference.
You know what would be the ultimate irony? Because, like, you know how Arc V, like, kind of starts bad, I said it gets better, and then it has a terrible ending?
Yes.
Wouldn't it be, like, the most tragic thing ever if Vrains has, like, an amazing third season?
No, because then I would... Well, like, it would be tragic because then I would have to watch it.
Yeah.
But the thing is, I don't think Vrains can have a good third season unless they pull a Yu-Gi-Oh! 5Ds and completely axe everything from Season 1 and Season 2 to tell an almost entirely different story with the same characters.
Oof. I haven't watched the rest of 5Ds.
5Ds is so weird. Like, Season 1 happens, and it's alright. Season 2 happens, and it's like the completion of Season 1. Season 3 happens, and you swear you're watching a different show. And it's like,
it kind of sounds like the final season of GX.
GX's final season is super strange, too, because, like, the thing is that same with GX and same with 5Ds, it's like everything kind of fell in a sequence and tied back into itself, but then it just split off into a completely different thing.
It'd be like if after like the Millennium World arc of the final season of regular Yu-Gi-Oh, that they had like a arc right after that where it's just all of them are just back together, even though like you, it's kind of like the new Yu-Gi-Oh, like the new movie.
The one with the darkness thing.
Yeah. It's kind of just like if that was like a season of like the final season of Yu-Gi-Oh, like it just happens after like that happens after the regular conclusion.
Original Yu-Gi-Oh had it the best because original Yu-Gi-Oh's arcs were consistent within themselves and self-contained. Like first came Duelist Kingdom, then came Battle City, then came whatever the heck with darts, then came the whole Yami Bakura death game. And before that came the big Seto Kaiba tournament. And it's like everything was kind of contained. But then with Yu-Gi-Oh! GX, seasons 1, 2, and 3, or arc 1, 2,
I love how you're just not even acknowledging the Noah arc.
The what arc?
What?
Do you not remember the Noah arc?
No, I forgot. I forgot about that. I'm sorry. Yes, the Noah arc.
Well, but it's like... What makes Yu-Gi-Oh! Like interesting in that regard is because it's based off the manga rather than the other way around, where we have mangas based off the animes. The original Yu-Gi-Oh! Has a couple filler seasons, so it doesn't really... So the main seasons where you have Duelist Kingdom, then you have the Battle City arc, then you have the Millennium World arc, those all kind of play in together. They all continue their own story arcs, where the anime have like these filler arcs in between, so it makes everything seem more compartmentalized and not as connected than what the actual through line of the story is. It's like we take pauses where in the overarching story.
I was gonna say, like, the original Yu-Gi-Oh! Anime was interesting because you basically had stories that you basically had the same group of characters going through different stories, so it almost felt like sequels to the same story except not done horribly. Like Yugi Moto and Joey Wheeler in The Adventures of Blank, and Yugi Moto and Hello's Friends in The Adventures of Blank, and they happen in the sequence, so it's the same characters, different setting. But with Yu-Gi-Oh! GX onwards, it feels like it's a consistent story that's constantly going, which is why stories that deviate from the original story give you such a weird whiplash, because suddenly you're on a completely different track, going in a completely different direction. And, you know, that might be fine, but it still gives you whiplash, because you suddenly are just pulled like a,
but
not a 180, but like a,
no, but I think
95.
I think that was sort of inevitable, because as I said, the manga, like, because the Yu-Gi-Oh anime was based, since it was based off a manga, there were times where they'd catch up to the manga, and then they'd have to, the way that these serialized shonen shows go, they make their own filler thing while they let the manga catch up rather than just waiting, because it makes too much money to wait.
Episode helicopter.
Where with GX and onwards, those were original animes. The mangas were based off the animes, so yeah. they didn't have to worry about making these compartmentalized filler arcs. So everything ran together.
And that's why, in GX and 5Ds, you have like those weird divides. Where, like, mm-hmm. GX Season 1 happens, and then GX Season 2 happens, and it's off the heels of GX Season 1. And then GX Season 3 happens, and it's right off the heels of GX Season 2. And then GX Season 4 happens, and it feels like we've started back at 1. And it's mm-hmm. like, you know, and that's fine. Season 4 is fine, but it's also, like, kind of weird whiplash when you're like, wait, hold on, like whoa. Like, I was on a long car ride, and now I'm driving in another direction. And then same with 5Ds, and it's like...
I think a better question is, why have the anime go through all of these extensive filler arcs when you can just have it hang out at the hot dog stand?
And this has been Bros in the Landfill.
Signing off for real this time!
Your mom!
Oof. It's time to get your game on in duel.
Should I stop recording?
Into the landfill.
Into the landfill.
Try. You sound sad. You're right.
You've activated my trap card. Landfill.
You've activated my trap card. Crippling sadness.